Thank you, Dr. Sancheti. That was very insightful. I would like to move on to General Arjun Ray. Sir, Dr. Sancheti has given all of us very important points on higher education and emerging trends in the Indian education. As the CEO of a well-known international school in India, what are your views on providing an inclusive environment for students? Are international curriculums emphasizing too much on the liberal arts and shifting the focus from stronger analytical forms of study such as mathematics or sciences? We'd like to hear your thoughts, sir, about this.
Mrs. Mundre, members of the panel, and ladies and gentlemen, because there are a few gentlemen in the audience also, I think it's a great opportunity for us to share our views on this very emotive subject about education in our country. I firmly believe that in the knowledge age, which we are already in, India's sustainability and economic growth will depend on the quality of human development. And the bottom line, as far as human development is concerned, is education. And within this parameter of education, I firmly believe that school education, that is primary and secondary education, will be more important than higher education. Because primary and secondary education provide the scaffolding, the foundation for higher education to flourish. One of the reasons higher education in India is under severe criticism is not because they are not good. It is because of the weakness, the pathetic weakness of the school education system in our country. A lot has been written about the Indian school system. I'll not go into detail, but I'll just select three particular aspects of our education system. It has plus points also, which are pulling us down. And the first thing I feel is the purpose of education. And here I would differ with Dr. Sancheti. I would differ with the Honorable Minister. If we look at our education system in the country, the Nehruvian model was that we needed a large pool of technical manpower to move these heavy industries, and that's how the IITs and IIMs came in over there. And that is why till today, despite the 21st century having arrived, parents and teachers in the world today in India, they want doctors and engineers, their children to be doctors and engineers. The Chinese believed in the same thing. The surprising part is that the Chinese school education system is now embraced the American education system of creativity and liberalism. And the American system is now trying to copy the Chinese system, which is nothing but the Indian system. The purpose of education in the 21st century cannot be to get jobs. It cannot be to secure high marks. I firmly believe that the purpose of education is to prepare children for life, the examination for life. They must have competencies, emotional competencies, spiritual competencies, aesthetic competencies to succeed. Marks by themselves are meaningless, absolutely meaningless. They have no value. And therefore we see a total absence of whole education. And I'll come to this a little later. And the second is rote memorization, to crack the examinations. We have a bizarre situation today that in the Delhi University, the cutoff for undergrad is 100%. And a student from Kerala three days back, was refused admission in Delhi University despite the fact that he had 100% marks. But let me tell you, this bizarre situation continues. I brought this newspaper. This is today's Times of India morning newspaper. About 4 or 5 days back, 73 students from IIT Roorkee were expelled because of underperformance. But they all passed that examination. And today the headline says, this year IITs will admit students with 6% marks. From 100% in Delhi University, our premier institution like the IIT, today's headline saying that the qualifying marks for students who are disadvantaged is 31 marks are acceptable out of 504. Now, can we make sense of it? This is why I would say that nearly 35% to 40% grads from IIMs and IITs are unemployable in MNCs and in leading premier institutions of our country today. And this is why, surprisingly, in 2009, there is something called a PISA. It's called the Performance for International Student Assessment. It is the yardstick, the golden measuring standard for education system. And it is under the OECD, which is a very distinguished organization in Paris. And they do maths, they do science, and they do reading. In 2009, out of 74 countries, India ranked number 72. And number 74 was Kyrgyzstan. And they were selected from two states of our country, that is Himachal Pradesh and Tamil Nadu, which are supposed to be having the best education system in the country. Thereafter, Indian education system decided that we will not take part in this competition ever again. The third important shortcoming in our system is the quality of teachers. I mean, I don't need to tell you that our B.Eds and our M.Eds in our country have no validity. And that is why in international schools, nobody actually pays any attention to B.Eds and to M.Eds. Today, becoming a teacher is the last choice of an individual. But if you look at the story, success story of Singapore, you look at the success story of Finland, you look at the success story of Japan, of Shanghai, I'm not saying China, but I'm saying Shanghai. The top 10% in the country go to education, not to IIT, not to IIM, not to doctors. The best 10% of the country are teachers. Their social status, their financial status is that they are the cream of the society. So if you throw peanuts, what do we get? We get monkeys. So I think this is a very, very important thing which we need to look at. And I feel that a time has come when we need to have something like the Indian Education Service. We need to have the provincial education service where the best people are given the best facilities and the opportunities to come in over here. Now, finally coming to this whole concept of international schools and international mindedness, which is, I think, a very interesting subject which you have selected, ma'am. The most confusing word, the most misrepresented word is international. It means so much to so many people. And now, because people have got tired of the word international, they're now using the word global. They say, global school hai hamara. And I'll tell you what international school is not. International school is not about infrastructure. If it was infrastructure, then Stanford and Harvard and many of the top universities of the world today would not be able to compete with some of the infrastructure we got in the country today. Infrastructure and facilities do not make you international mindedness. And the second thing, people believe that if you have diversity in staff, you got expats with you, you got people from different countries over there, you can have them over there and you can still not be international. And I'll throw a challenge. You can have an international syllabus like the International Baccalaureate, like the Cambridge, like the EdExcel, and still not be international. Because there's a difference between syllabus and curriculum. Syllabus is just information. What to do, how to make sense of that syllabus, how to apply that syllabus in real life situation is curriculum. What to do is syllabus and how to do is curriculum. And most international schools in India today, and there are about over 100 of them, focus more on syllabus and less on curriculum. So what do we do? can we use the international school model in its correct sense and see whether it can help us in improving the school education system and thereby in the process the higher education system? I think the first thing is preparation, is the purpose of education. It is surprising that 3,000 years back, the sages in the Upanishad, what they said about the purpose of education, what great philosophers and educationists, right from Einstein to Bertrand Russell to John Dewey to anybody, to J. Krishnamurti, to Mahatma Gandhi, anybody, what they said about the purpose of education is relevant today and will be relevant 3,000 years from today. And the purpose of education is not to get a job, although getting job is important. The purpose of education is to prepare a child for life. And therefore, education, school education, and college, it is too late. There's very little you can do about it. You're inheriting something. Would include giving them what I would call survival competencies for the 21st century. And I say survival competencies because it includes things like critical thinking, which we are not very good in, about problem solving, especially when we are working in ambiguous situations, uncertain situations. Competencies to deal with big picture thinking. Ladies and gentlemen, 21st century is what I would call, if you can remember this acronym, VUCA, V-U-C-A, VUCA. It is volatile. Life today is volatile, it is uncertain, it is complex, it is messy, it is ambiguous. Getting 100 out of 100 in maths will not enable you to get through VUCA. You need competencies, emotional competencies, you need aesthetic competencies. And therefore this is part of school education. So when you teach chemistry, you teach mathematics, you teach physics, you also got to teach them these competencies along with that. And lifelong learning, of course, is something very, very important. And this brings me to this whole aspect about the purpose of education is preparation for life, and you can only prepare the child if you unlock the potential in the child. And this is the transformation that has to take place. Ladies and gentlemen, the best out of us, the best out of us use only 8% of our human potential. And like the iceberg, 90% is down. That's why we say tip of the iceberg. Don't we say that?
Yeah.
So the aim is to get this out. The talent, the signature strengths, the divinity of a person, the goodness of a human being, values, this has got to be brought out. So this brings me to the second big change that we need to bring about, and that is the role of the teacher. We believe that the role of the teacher is not to teach. It is not to, that very fancy word being used now, facilitate, although teaching and facilitation are involved. It is to unlock her potential first. If she cannot unlock her potential, she cannot unlock the potential of the child. Therefore, she has to teach the child and not just the subject. She has to teach the child and not just the subject. And to put it in an enigmatic form, I would say, in today's world, and Dr. Sancheti emphasized this particular aspect over there, is teachers should be trained to teach what Google cannot teach.
Absolutely.
70% or 80% of what is there in the classroom is available on Google and in a better format. Teacher has got to teach what Google cannot teach. And the day she can do that, and that should be the focus of her training, she will be able to be the teacher we're looking at. And thirdly, of course, as Abba very rightly brought out right in the beginning, and so did Rati over there, is that schools must be inclusive. We cannot have cut-off admissions. Some of the international schools, even in Bangalore, have a cut-off. Many of the schools in India have cut-off over there. It has to be inclusive. It has to be inclusive in the sense that children of different abilities have to be brought in. Because life teaches us that success in life is not determined by IQ. Success in life is determined by emotional quotient and by spiritual quotient. And I would say aesthetic quotient. Most people have a wrong understanding of aesthetics. When we say the word aesthetics, we say, oh, she is very aesthetic, he is very aesthetic. That means she is very arty, she is very creative. That is not what aesthetic means. Aesthetics is your ability to see beauty in ugliness. To see good in bad. And the most perfect person in life, there is no such thing as perfection. The only perfect person is an imperfect person. Therefore, aesthetics is the ability to love an imperfect person. So this is the, I would say, what to me stands for inclusivity. And lastly, of course, I would only say that future competition between nations is not going to be between competing economic ideologies or political systems. It's going to be between competing education systems. And within education, we have to win the war at the primary level. Remember that 50% of human learning stops at the age of 10. 50%, that is the critical window. If we lose that window, we have lost the war when we come to college and to university. Thank you very much.